What's up, everybody? It's the Hardy Construction. You can find us on Tumblr, Twitter, Facebook, as well as Instagram with your host Comp and...
Yanda!
Today's film is...
The Evil Within, 2017.
Teens. The Evil Within, 2017. The sadistic tale of lonely, mentally handicapped boy who befriends his reflection in an antique mirror. This Whoa. Demonic creature orders him to go on a murderous rampage to kill the people he loves most. Directed by Andrew Getty. Written by Andrew Getty. Stars Frederick Kohler, Sean Patrick Flannery, oh boy, Brianna Brown, Dina Meyer,
Michael Berryman,
Francis Gulnan, Kim Darby, as well as Tim Bagley and Grayson Turner, as well as
who? There were like Deanna three people in the movie. Who are all these people?
I don't know. I don't remember these. Remember that crazy guy who said, "Oh no, these are your brother's books" at the end because he was so important.
Yo, that guy was the worst actor. So I couldn't believe it. Like,
okay, I think he was playing a character. So let's get into it. So this movie. Why'd I pick this movie, Danny? So, why'd I pick this film? The Evil Within. I had seen the trailer for this, and it looked absolutely ridiculous, the original trailer for it. But there was something about it that stuck with me, the way that...
Did the trailer look, like, stupid?
Yes. But it had Michael Berryman in it. And I don't really... I'm not, like, a huge Michael Berryman fan, but, you know, I do understand his importance in the horror subculture.
He tends to be in a lot of like really groundbreaking stuff.
He was in, I guess, most known by for The Hills Have Eyes, I guess. Well, at least I remember part two or something. I remember seeing a poster of his face, and when I was a kid, I was like, I'd always mistake him for the Toxic Avenger.
He's also in The Guyver, I believe.
Can you look up what his disease, or not his disease, but like, is it acromegaly or something that he, or he was just born sort of looking like that?
Hypohidrotic ectodermal dysplasia.
Okay,
which
so that's
leaves
like water.
Him with no sweat glands, hair, fingernails,
oh
or
my God.
Teeth.
He can't sweat. That sounds fantastic. Oh my gosh, that would have been so good for me in high school. I feel bad actually, but what I remember him mostly was from his fantastic cameo in Weird Science. I don't know if you've ever seen Weird Science,
the movie or the show.
The movie. Have you ever seen?
I don't remember.
Oh my God, the movie.
It's been a while since I've seen that movie.
There's a scene where. The girlfriend Lisa, she's like this computer control
I love
created
Lisa.
By these two teenagers, played by Kelly LeBrock, I think her name was. Super hot British chick. Anyway, so she
really
sends
is.
These bikers from hell to like instigate a violence at this party that the two teenagers, Andrew, whatever the hell his name is, the two kids, whatever. One of them is from the Breakfast Club. Anyway, right. So there, Michael Berryman's there, and they're like these. There's like a guy with half of a robot face. There's like, remember, you ever seen Mad Max 2?
Is that the bikers?
Yes, scene? The bikers. He's one of the bikers.
Okay.
And there's even one of the guys from Mad Max. It's fucking great. It's like so funny, and Michael Berryman's like great. And there's like a. You just gotta watch Weird Science. Weird Science is one of the greatest.
No, I've seen it. It's
you know
it's
what?
Been,
I
it's
read
been a while.
I read an article recently, or I was trying to read an article, but then I was just too infuriated about it. Molly Ringwald, she wrote an article about how... Who's the guy that directed those movies, like Home Alone and Weird Science? And
John Hughes.
John Hughes. She said she wrote this big article about watching 16 Candles or whatever that John Hughes directed. You know, a movie that everybody sort of loved?
Yeah.
Oh, no, The Breakfast Club.
He did 16 Candles, too. He did both of them.
Well, all right, but he did The Breakfast Club, and there's a scene where that guy with the big schnoz, I forgot his name, is Judd Nelson. He, like, goes under the table and looks under her skirt, and then it's like, it might be mentioned that he fingers her or something, and she goes, I can see how that's problematic, and this film is, and I was like, are you kidding me? So she's, like, writing off John Hughes as a pig or something now because of the movie. So I don't know. I didn't read the rest of the article. I don't know if she had actual problems with John Hughes, but... I love those movies. Well, Weird Science and The Breakfast Club are great. Anyway.
Well, let's talk about this movie.
Yeah, what are we talking about? Oh,
the,
so
evil
the reason why I picked this movie is because I saw the trailer with Michael, and there's a sequence where Michael Berryman and his face is all morphing and weird. It's from one of the nightmare sequences. Mm-hmm. And it just looked cool. Like, it looked cheap from the trailer, but it looked pretty cool.
It's
and
cheap, like, but in, like, a creepy way, though.
Yeah, yeah. There's something about this movie that's really unsettling, but it really speaks to me with this film.
The backstory kind of, like, makes it so much better.
Yes. When you read the backstory about this film, this movie is the one and only film by a millionaire heir called Andrew Getty.
To the Getty Gas Company.
Right. Right? Actually, he was actually losing money because I think he spent about $7 million on this film.
Yeah, he was like eating like cereal, I was reading.
So I read that too. So if you read up the Hollywood, just look up Hollywood Reporter, Andrew Getty, The Evil Within. And this film, for the most part, I see it gets mixed reviews. It hasn't got out and out bad reviews for it.
So, like weird shit though. Like that character at the end that with the mixed up books, he says a line in there that's like, "Yo, like this is the worst acting I've ever seen." Like, this like call the cops. And he's like, "I don't wanna."
Okay, so to preface it, Andrew Getty was obviously an heir for like millions of dollars. He died at 47 due to complications of internal bleeding
and like meth or something.
And he had heart problems. He had a lot. He did a lot of meth. So, but the thing is with this film, this was his only film, and the thing is, when I also, there's a YouTube channel where they interview the main actor from this film, Frederick Kohler, and he's explaining his experience on set of the film. Here's the thing, this movie took 15 years to distribute, right? It was shot in 2001. From 2001 till, I believe, 2006, it was shot. It actually cycled through lots of different actors.
Yeah, I was saying all the actors changed and
so the only three actors that from the beginning of this film that stayed were Frederick Kohler, who plays the main character of Dennis, Michael Berryman, as well as the, you know, the lady that runs the child home, you know, the lady with the glasses.
What about, oh, I hate her. What about the brother, though?
Those are the only three actors. There was a different brother and girlfriend, two different couples, and then this and then this couple. So it's like really, there's a lot of shit going on. And the thing is why people don't dismiss this film as a vanity project for like a millionaire. You know what I mean? Because I'm sure there's a lot of millionaires that were like...
No, it's legit. This is
like,
a Danny,
good movie. You and I personally know people that use arts as vanity projects. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So this, apparently what this is that this guy had these, Andrew Getty had these nightmares. Very vivid nightmares when he was younger, and he actually, including the opening sequence with the roller coaster, the haunted house roller coaster, whatever that little, whatever those are called, and he wanted to put it to film, so he put all his money behind this project, and he used basically his house for the set of the film. It's a very nice looking house, although you don't really see all of it. You can tell there's a lot of money.
Can you imagine living in that house? I mean, did you see how many floors were in that house?
Yeah, like just from the staircase.
Although he built a lot of sets, though, apparently, too.
He actually made a post-production room in his house. That's how much into it. So they filmed the movie in 5 years, right? And then the rest of the time, he was just
doing special effects.
In-house special effects for the film. That's what he was doing. He wasn't just.
This is the thing. If he could have hired, and this is why I respect him, but also think he's crazy. He could have hired, like, he's a millionaire. He could have hired, you know, professionals.
I'm sure
to do the
did.
Special
no, no.
effects.
The reason, the thing is, the movie looks good, and that's why he hired professionals for it. If you can watch this film, here's the thing. This type of film looks like it should have had a $2 million or $500,000 budget, right? Like a cheap budget, but because it had a decent budget for it. That's why it looks good. It's not a shit. It's not a bad looking movie.
But he
at all.
Like apparently, didn't he like build or like
he built
take, like
he
direct...
built like his own like camera rigs. I really wish.
That and he did like the animatronic spider thing. Like he like made that, I think. Or
right.
Something.
Yeah. That's why, because there's that whole scene. Like, we're gonna discuss the film, but right now we're just gonna talk the backstory of this movie is really fascinating, and I wish that the movie wasn't just kind of dumped on video on demand. You know what I mean? Like, this movie would have been cool if it had, like, I don't think people would have liked it without knowing this backstory. That's why I think I appreciate it more, because I knew the backstory. Because
it's still a good movie. It's a unique movie.
It's good. It is very unique. It is unique, but I don't know whether that's informed by me knowing the background of it. Do you know what I mean?
No, it is unique. The way it's shot is crazy.
It is like crazy. Somebody,
like, there's a point where I forget what it was. It was just like the brother sitting at a table, something very nothing happening, and it does this crazy pan out from the side of his head and the camera swivels sideways. It was like, what is happening right now? This is so bizarre.
This is a bizarre film that I think one of the reviewers said akin to it. I'm paraphrasing. But they said it's like a fever dream made by somebody who's clearly on drugs.
That's what it seems like.
And it is. It really is like an insane film.
And you don't know when it's a dream and shit. It's very surreal. This is a very creepy movie.
And somebody was saying that, like, you know how movies like The Room sort of got that cult following? They said maybe in 10 to 20 years this movie could have a cult following like that.
But this movie is... I mean, The Room is a cult following because it's terrible. This is a good movie.
Yeah, it's a legitimately watchable film. You know what I mean? It's messy in some parts, like from the middle, but that has to do with production issues and how dedicated the director was to putting the story together. Because obviously there's stuff that you don't know, like that guy with the book stuff. Mm-hmm. Like when the main
character... That was the worst actor. Like, it stood out so bad. The thing is,
I think I've seen that guy before, and he might be actually a good actor, just weird in this film. Because his delivery is so strange. Let's just talk about that one scene first. Because I have a theory about that. Obviously, this is spoilers, this whole episode. I believe, but it wasn't implicit. Mm-hmm. I believe the brother, who is played by Sean Patrick Flanery, who I didn't recognize. I was like, where do I know this guy? And he was like the Boondock Saints. Him right. and his girlfriend. Who was his girlfriend in the movie? That was Kim... not Kim Darby.
Lydia?
Lydia. So Dina, that's Dina Meyer. Yeah. I know I've seen Dina Meyer in a lot of shit. I just don't know where I've
She's
seen
her. She's in Johnny from. Mnemonic.
I didn't see that movie, but I know I've seen her face before.
Dragonheart, Starship Troopers.
Oh, okay. Starship Troopers is where I know her from. Who the hell is she in Saw?
She's a detective.
Okay. Yeah, you're right. Okay, now I remember her completely. I remember her from Starship Troopers. Anyway, so the brother and her. So the brother, John and Lydia, I think they're sucked into the dark world. While they're sleeping. Because remember...
Really?
Listen, don't... Remember when they're walking and nobody's paying attention to them at the restaurants and everything is fucking weird? And they said it. Remember at the beginning... The previous night, remember when he had killed that guy in the bathroom? And the brother goes up to him. This is where I think some of the shitty writing kind of comes through. His brother says, hey, take a bath, man. You stink. And then he just walks away. And then it cuts to them waking up. And the sister's like, didn't you just tell your brother to brush his teeth? He goes, no. So I think that was the evil version of the main character, Dennis, because he's able to turn into people. Remember, he turned into that cop, and then he turned into himself. I think he turned into his brother and told him to take a bath. See, this is where I don't know. I think they fell into that world.
Wait,
and
you that's think why that the brother... Wait, I'm confused.
I think from the point where he tells his brother to take a bath, remember?
Can we refer to the Michael Berryman character as the storyteller from now on so it's not confusing?
Oh, I thought he was a Korean man, because remember he said his name was Lee Jun? Get it? Lee Jun? I'm so funny. No, Legion. Anyway, did I say Legion? Anyway.
Legion.
So, okay, so this is... I'm going to talk about this ending right now, just to kind of... This is my theory of what happens, and I hope this is what lines
it
up.
It is confusing. Like, it's like, is it crazy? Is there a paranormal thing?
There
like,
is an absolutely frightening scene at a Chuck E. Cheese knockoff place.
Oh, yeah.
We'll get to that. But anyway, after that, he kills some guy, and then I think... Who does he kill last? He kills the girl at the ice cream shop, and then I think he kills the cops.
He kills that awful woman that wanted to take him away.
Okay, so this is before that. He kills the guy in the bathroom, and I think every scene after the bathroom is taking place in the dark world, or whatever it's called. Not the upside down, but whatever the fuck place it is called.
I think it's called the dark world.
The dark world, right? Because...
Yeah.
Everything that plays out towards that is very dreamlike. There's weird shit going on. Like, the brother and the girlfriend are noticing that nobody's paying attention to them. Only, like, one lady pays attention to him. He thinks he sees his psychiatrist, and it turns out to be Tiny from Devil's Reject, an actor who died, like, fucking 2003 or something, 2005. And also, that guy's huge, man. When he puts his hand on, he grabs both
his well, that guy is... in a bunch of shit. He's in Devil's Rejects. He's in... I can't think of anything else, but I know he's in a bunch of shit because I've seen him in everything.
So you notice nobody's paid attention. So obviously the dark world is basically the warped version of reality. And it's still in that version of the world, the lady who runs that, I guess, house for kids, she's bringing cops over. Because you notice when the brother gets stuck in the chair and everything, and then he, you know, blows his brains out, Dennis gets sort of sucked through a window or something, and he's taken away by real cops at the end.
Yeah.
So he's like, you notice he's no longer in a tuxedo and all that shit. He's in normal clothing. So mm-hmm. I think that latter 15 minutes of the film takes place in the dark side.
Because also, like, if I was the brother, what the hell is the brother's name? John. If I was John, the brother, and I saw my brother's got brain damage, and very all of a sudden he's talking perfectly normal, and my girlfriend,
yes,
who has never liked him, is talking perfectly normal. Well, I think she is until I realized.
I don't think that was his girlfriend who was the puppet. That looked like somebody else, or was that?
No, that was Lydia. He hollowed out her head with the drill.
Oh, okay, right.
God. But if I saw them sitting there talking perfectly normal, I'd be like immediately like, what's happening? But he's like laughing as he's glued to a chair. And then also, I think he dropped the ball because he could have had his skin rip off on the arms, but he didn't really.
Yeah, I mean, there was a spider with a digitized woman's head on it. All right, so let's go to the beginning of this film. So
that was fun.
So, but do you think maybe that's what the possibility was, that they were on this? Because remember when it starts showing two sides. Remember there's a part where specifically it shows double of the room?
Like, well, you do see. I mean, there's no way that he could have rigged up all of that stuff.
And it's very interesting with the actual, like, you know, when they have that discussion of the octopus and how it works through
animatronics. Yeah, and then he made that
and
spider,
I thought
yeah.
that was just some sort of fucking info dump for no reason. Like, I was watching it going, this is like something, who's that guy who wrote Fight Club? Chuck Palahniuk?
Yeah.
He always puts like some weird info dump in the book that has nothing to do with the storyline, or maybe it does, but I was like, why did he just completely...
He had a thing in the book Survivor. It was like all about like the something like really specific about like how to like properly set tables in rich people's homes or something.
Yeah, there was like, I read I think Lullaby, and that had like a really deep explanation of how a body contorts when it's like, it's just really disgusting explanation, but it's a good book, Lullaby. Anyway, so we'll but that whole like,
you might be right, because there's no way a real person could rig up that much stuff in the space of what, like 2 hours? Like, he couldn't make.
I mean, he was doing it the day before. Remember? It's malarkey. There's something going on with that.
But then again, he is a supernatural being now, so maybe he can. I don't know.
But we'll get to that sequence, because that's my absolute favorite sequence of the film, because it's so bizarre and so fuck. I had like goosebumps watching.
Yeah, he showed me a picture of his goosebumps.
There was something so absolutely unnerving about that scene. Anyway, so Frederick Kohler, the main character, very good actor, playing Dennis.
Son of Schillinger in Oz.
Okay. And I know I've seen him in stuff, but apparently he's in a lot of the direct-to-DVD... what the hell is that movie? It's with Jason Statham, and he plays a guy named Frankenstein who's driving... Death Race. So he's in a lot of Death Race sequels. He's a very good actor. And the thing is, he's playing a mentally disabled young man, or slow, as he says it himself, character. And it's not comical. Like, I've seen a lot of movies where people, like, what did they say?
No, he did a good job.
In Tropic Thunder, they say, don't go full R-word. He doesn't do that here. It's like and the thing is, I was watching clips of him online, and he plays a similar character in, I believe, this show called whatever.
He was also in American Horror Story.
Oh, who was? Do you remember who he was? Yeah, I remember seeing his name on the IMDb, but I don't remember who he was.
Roanoke, whatever. I never saw that season.
He was on the show on Roanoke. Oh, I gotta look him up. In Roanoke. I saw that. I like that season. But he was in some sort of CBS sort of procedural show, and he's basically playing the same character, like a slow-witted character, but he's actually smart. Mm-hmm. So anyway, with this film, Frederick Kohler, there's a narration in the very beginning of this film, and because I'm watching the film going, okay, so apparently, you know, from the trailer it looked goofy, and I was thinking, okay, this movie just might be shit because it's a rich guy who made it, you know, died mm-hmm. before it came out. And I was actually impressed this dream of this dilapidated, what is it, like a county fair or something like that.
I knew I liked it as soon as the Michael Berryman climbed and zipped inside his body.
Like, I knew when I saw that, I was like, oh, Danny's going to like this because it was bizarre. There's a scene where Michael...
It was so creepy.
There's just all this nightmare shit that happens in the beginning, and, like, the mother, you know, she's not paying attention to him. She talks, and her eyeballs are mouths and stuff like that. It's a very surreal film. I don't even know how to describe stuff in the film other than the main plot line is basically... Dennis is living with his brother. Dennis is slow, as he says. And his brother is, I guess, running out of money, taking care of, you know, the family because he can't really get a real job. He can't marry his girlfriend,
he's
Lydia.
Fucking rich. He lives in a mansion, so...
Right, but I think they're trying to sell the house because I think they're just running out of money in general.
Yeah.
There's a lot of subplots that pop up out of nowhere that don't fit in the main film because it seems like they reference them and you're supposed to have some sort of knowledge of what these storylines are.
Like what?
He's talking about his psychiatrist. So you're thinking there's some sort of...
Oh, yeah. There was, like, what was the deal with that? The psychiatrist is, like, waiting at a restaurant for him?
He couldn't afford the psychiatrist, so he said, you know, can you talk to me on your lunch breaks? That's basically what that was. So I don't know what that was about. And then there's a scene where it's clearly DVDs. They mentioned them as DVDs.
Books
that,
on tapes, though,
that
yeah.
Dennis... Was it books on tapes or DVDs?
They said it was books on tapes, but it didn't look like any books on tapes.
Oh, is that
what
he said?
Oh,
I just sworn they were DVDs. That's why I was like, why are they books, you know, later on? And you could tell that's like 2001, so maybe that's why they're so...
Nah, they're books on tapes.
Okay, so that makes sense. But then also, you know, that guy who you like says the worst actor, the main guy... This is a character that doesn't show up in the movie until that lasts like 10 minutes.
It's like, call the cops. And he's like, I don't wanna.
John is like, hey, there's this character, this so-and-so. And I was like, well, who the fuck is this? I don't know who this character was.
Yeah, it was really like out of nowhere. Like, it was like, to me, the worst part of the whole movie.
That made me wonder why, you know, I wish that there was a behind the scenes of this film. Like, somebody just shot a documentary about this movie.
Yeah.
Because that movie would have been fucking fascinating.
They
could have
cut out that whole scene. Yeah, no, you're right. That would have been awesome.
I am sure there is enough footage of the making of this film to make a fucking fantastic behind the scenes film.
I'd have loved to see the other actors who did their roles too.
Oh,
that
yeah,
would be
I would love to know the movie behind, because there was a movie called The Island of Dr. Moreau, a movie that apparently was a real piece of shit, and it starred Marlon Brando.
That was based on another movie called The Island of Dr. Moreau.
Yeah, The Island of Lost Souls, I think it was. And okay. It also had the third Batman, the guy who's apparently like a real
Val Kilmer.
Val Kilmer's like a real piece of shit to work with. And apparently it was like a real shit show to make that movie. And they made a documentary about it that's like supposedly very funny and very weird and like bizarre. So I could imagine they could do something even more incredible with this film. Because it's not a bad movie. It's just that the story is so great about it behind the scenes. So anyway, Dennis, John brings in, for some reason, he buys a gigantic mirror that he wants to install in Dennis's room.
Because he thinks he'll up the value of the house.
Up the value of selling. They're not bringing anybody around to look at the house just yet.
But so what's weird is like, okay, like fine. The mirror's not haunted. It's just the guy, Michael Berryman, lives in the mirror. So it's like, has this kid never seen his reflection before? Like,
I'm thinking the mirror is a catalyst. And here's the thing. We're stretching what we're thinking about this film. Well, at least I am. Because I think that the bringing of the mirror in the room is a catalyst of him just sort of... the break of his mental facilities, finally.
Right.
I don't know. Because apparently, you know, we find out later on that he was a genius. But the fight with his brother says that he just, like, punched him and he, fell down the stairs. But when in the reenactment, we see that his brother hit him over the head with a bat and he did a backflip down the staircase.
He probably was like lying to his girlfriend.
He probably wanted to make it as worse as it sounded. Anyway, so that's what I think. I think that it exacerbated the situation. And he just had a psychotic break. And there's like actual interesting things about what he says. The character saying, "If I had a dream and I'm trying to scare myself, why wouldn't I know it? So, you know, why is there two sides of my brain trying to trick itself?"
Yeah,
and I was
like,
"Yeah, I never thought about that. Like, you know, as if you can't tell a joke to yourself because you would know the punchline." And I was like, "You know, that's actually pretty fascinating."
Yeah, but that is interesting. But when you're in a dream, you're not
in control. Necessarily.
You're not consciously awake, so it's not like you don't see what's coming because it's just a blob out of your subconscious.
What's one of the worst nightmares you've ever had?
it, like, people I know, like, dying and then, like, being mad at me and not answering as I'm trying to ask them why they're mad at me, like, shit like that. I don't get scared of, like, I don't get scared of actual scary stuff. I actually enjoy those dreams.
There was a ride, I don't know if it's called the Flying Witch or something, at Rye Playland, which I think is this old theme park in upstate New York, in Rye, New York. And I remember looking. It's called.
Oh, I have actually worked like right over there.
Have you there? Yeah. They're changing it into a Legoland now because Rye. Oh, literally, they did not update any of their rides since fucking 1932. Everything looks like it hasn't been cleaned because they're fucking. It's a dump. Anyway, so good luck with Legoland. But the ride is like one of those sort of, you know, just like in the beginning of this film where you just sit down in a car and it goes into this little spooky house and there's like loud sound effects and shit. Right. It scared the shit out of me when I saw it as a kid because when I saw it. But anyway, but it's like this whole like 80s cool graphic on the outside. If you Google like Flying Witch Rye Playland, you'll see what I saw as a kid.
Okay.
And essentially it's like 80s sort of cool graffiti of monsters and like there's a giant demon face.
Wow,
and
I'm gonna have to look that up because I've driven past it, but I've never been.
And there's these weird elves playing flutes, flipping left and right, like animatronics of it. And I remember just looking at them and being bothered. And then I had a dream where I was over at like around that area, and there was like a steep hill for some reason. I tumbled down this steep hill, and I was trying to climb up it, and these elves were chasing me up the hill, and I was fucking. It was the. To me, that's the nightmare that I remember of all nightmares. I don't know, because it was so real. Mm-hmm. And it was just these weird-looking elves. And they had beards and, like, hats. And they were just, like, following me up this rampway that was, like, grass or something. And I was just, you know, horrified trying to climb up as they descended on me. It was the most frightening.
That sounds pretty scary.
And the only other, I think, nightmare I remember, because it had a stupid effect, is that I fall out of a window, because, like, the floor is, like, changing, and I actually fell off my bed. So I woke up hitting the floor as I fell out the window, so it, like, actually happened. It was so frightening. Wow. Anyway, so this film has to deal with those sort of dreams.
I've had really surreal fucking weird dreams, yeah, but they're not scary, though. Like, that's the thing.
Yeah, they're really, like, they're upsetting and bizarre, but they're not necessarily scary. I'm sure if
like, when I wake up, even if I am scared, I wake up and, like, that was amazing. Like, even no matter how morbid it is, I'm always happy about it.
Because like, if you're a kid and you see this movie, this is probably one of the most horrifying movies you'll ever see.
Oh, yeah, no, like, this is just him zipping up his body.
I thought he was gonna fuck him in the ass or something when I
saw it. That's what I thought at first too.
And then he unzips him. Like, I thought it was gonna be some child predator thing that happens. But and he was actually in. I think he just graduated college when he filmed this. Like, he sort of looks the same now, the actor. But I didn't know how old he was. He looks sort of like 30. He's playing a 30-year-old in the film. Right. But anyway, so you know, he's upset that his brother puts this mirror in his room. His brother just doesn't give a fuck. I think his brother's just tired of his brother says that he owes him his life, but he sort of is a dickhead to him.
And yeah, his brother's a condescending prick, and I hate his girlfriend.
His girlfriend's sort of an asshole. Like, she wants to get married, and she just doesn't want to live with his brother there.
But then she does become nice when she finds out the backstory to her demise.
Right, and there's an ice cream girl that's there, and
yeah.
She's hot. That's
she is hot. Susan, Brianna Brown.
Yeah, Brianna Brown. She's hot, and I'm sure she was. I'm very sure because she has like a full frontal nudity scene.
I definitely would have hit her with my car if I could. That turns me on.
she. It's so funny because I'm sure she's like. She now acts and other stuff, and she fights for feminism stuff like that. And I'm sure they were like, "Hey, Brianna, guess what? You know that movie we made 15 years ago? We show your pussy and everything. We're gonna release it." She's like, "Oh, fuck."
Wait, did they film that in the beginning though, or is she?
I don't know when. Obviously, the movie was finished shot in 2005 or 2006.
No, it says I'm looking at the her thing. It says filmed in 2002.
Her scene?
Yeah.
Okay, well, there you go. Her stuff was shot in 2002, so I'm sure she was like, "Oh God, 14 years ago. What the fuck was I thinking?"
I'm glad. I'm glad that.
No, it's there. A very nice scene. So anyway,
it was one of my favorite scenes in the whole movie.
So the whole like, and it's not cheesy that he's having these conversations with himself, because obviously one time he just has a conversation with himself in the mirror, and there's like obviously the evil version of, and he's very good at that sort of ice cold.
It's very Gollum in Return of the King.
Right, and it's really good acting on his part because he has to interact with himself, and he has that great sort of dead look in his face. He has that sort of. Like, a lot of people shit on the movie, but Psycho with the remake, which was like
a useless
remake, but Vince Vaughn was like a really good psychopath in it.
Yeah.
And he has like a
Why
really
did
good,
they make that?
Because they're stupid. I don't know. You know what they did? They added special effect. This is what they added to the movie, from what I remember from the original. They added like weird Nine Inch Nails visuals for some reason. It's a shot for shot remake of the original film.
The same thing with The Omen, though. They did a pointless remake of that, too.
You see Anne Heche's butthole, and then there's a scene of Vince Vaughn jerking off.
That's kind of... that's nice, the butthole.
I remember watching it, and, like, he's jerking off, and it's like a full... They don't show his... You know, they just show his arm doing it, because he's looking at her through a hole in the wall. And then really loudly, like, after he jizzes, I did the jizz sound effect, like, in the theater. I was like, and everybody was like, oh, laughing, and I felt, like, really proud of myself. That was one of my greatest jokes. Anyway, so you didn't laugh. So the joke, I mean, the thing with this film is that it's basically that he's being turned to the dark side. Michael Berryman is, I guess, the actual Legion or the demon or Satan or whatever he thinks it is. You don't really know whether it's really evil or what, or is just his mind fucking up. Michael Barron is cool looking. He's like has this dark, like purplish, dark bluish, complexion.
Yeah, he's really creepy because it like looks like not real, but also like crappy, but also really good.
Yeah, he looks like CG, and I'm sure there's some sort of. Although apparently the director did not want to use much CG in this film, but you can tell there's a lot of CG in this film somewhere. Yeah, so basically he's telling him, "Yo, you got to kill a cat." He's trying to move up, and his explanation is that, listen, the butcher is killing animals, so why is it different that you kill animals? It's not illegal, is it? You know, so it's basically...
Well, that one made sense. I could see that. Like, I could see that logic, but the other ones were just, like, weird.
So he kills a little kitten cat, or tabby cat, and he feels remorse about it, and then he kills a kid who's at the park by himself. It's not that graphical. You do see him throw a body inside of a freezer and stinking up the house, and... His brother John's pretty oblivious. It's so funny because he's like, "Wait, what are these these books on tapes about fucking taxidermy?" And the house stinks. And then his girlfriend calls. Goes, "Okay, I'll see you later," and he just leaves. Right. It's like, what the hell? But basically, you know, it goes in succession of him killing killing the girl that he likes. He kills a cat. He kills a kid. He kills the girl that he's in love with, and she's like, "No, I can't date you because of, you know, I mean, you're." It wouldn't work out, and he's like,
"What is that supposed to mean?"
He doesn't take his rejection real well. So he doesn't take it so well that he's able to light speed warp back into the back of
and jump out the ceiling like a ninja.
Yeah, he's doing a handstand on the fucking door. I was like, "Wow, this gives you superpowers!" Like whatever the fuck he has. It reminded me of the reverse of Michael Myers in H2O, who's like hanging by one arm from the ceiling. This guy can actually.
That was a terrible, terrible movie.
That was a cool visual, though, with him descending from the ceiling with the arm.
But it was
thing about that movie. Yeah, the movie's bad. Anyway, so it all eventually leads up to this absolutely. I don't know why I was so disturbed by the Chuck E. Cheese place.
You know, I used to go... You can't go by yourself anymore because they think you're like a pedo. But, like, I used to go there with my friends and we just watched the deranged dolls at Nathan's and Chuck E. Cheese. Nathan's had it, too. They retired them now, though.
They still have my Chuck E. Cheese. It always bothered me that they updated Chucky's look from Chuck E. Cheese from, like, a cartoon big-headed mouse to, like, just a regular-looking mouse. So I'm like... Why would you want a mouse, you know, associated with your food? Like, he's running around. But, yeah, I guess Chuck E. Cheese has these animatronic animals that play. It's apparently a huge thing on the internet. There's so much so that there's a thing called Five Nights at Freddy's, which is a video game that people play on the... And basically with the video, I saw, like, some play, because I was hearing about it. I was like, what the fuck is this about? Essentially, you're playing a guy who's working overnight at, like, at a pizza, like, one of those places, like Chuck E. Cheese's. Uh-huh. And the thing is, those machines are fucking alive. So in the game, you're essentially watching all the closed-circuit televisions to make sure nothing's, like, moving around. And I guess if you fuck up, the thing just pops up in front of you. It's like a horror game, and it pops up, and they look, like, really fucked up and, like, half-broken machines.
I used to, like, love it. There was a... I guess it was, like, an octopus that played drums or something.
Talking about this one.
No, I'm talking about in real life. The Nathan's animatronic shit. They had like an octopus.
I had no idea Nathan's had that. Yeah.
The one that I grew up near my Hold on.
Animal, you know, for in New York City, for a whopping $8, you can have a hot dog, a Nathan's hot dog. A
fantastic, oh, right. Burger. What, at Coney Island you talking
no,
about?
No, no, no. In the mobile, like, Nathan's really? Hot dog stands. Like, you get a whopping $9. You can that's, $8 to $9. That's one insanity. Fucking hot dog with a soda.
Just because it's Nathan's, so they think scumbags. It's famous. Scumbags. Anyway. I wonder how much it costs in Coney Island, the original. I'm sure it's
normal, maybe $2 or something.
You think it's normal? No, it's probably so much worse.
Probably. I don't know. I don't know.
I can't find this octopus thing, but there is I'm sure there if you is Google like
Five,
a...
Just look up Five Nights at Freddy's or Nathan's. I had no idea Nathan's actually had an animatronic band, but apparently that's still a big stuff, and people collect them, and people film them everywhere. Oh, God, it's
scary. I'm looking
it's
at
really
it
disturbing,
now.
And in the film... There's like a weird, but these are like the cheap. It's so funny because everything else looks really good, like all the monster.
No, but the
designs.
Cheapness is what makes them scary.
Right. I don't even know what the fuck it was. I was watching it on a small on my phone at the gym. This movie when uh-huh. that scene came up, and you know, it comes to this whole like one shot of a camera, and they're like, oh hi Dennis, you know, these guys in sailor outfits. So it's like a sailor themed sort of restaurant. Mm-hmm. And then it's like, you hear that song. I couldn't get that song out of my head. It was like, the girls are over there.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like a weird disco song. And then like it goes to this girl who has the menus. Then it closes up on this. And I was looking at it on the screen. I was like, what the fuck is that? It's like a monkey man yeah. or something singing. But it was like moving all
yeah,
weird.
Its face is all like weird.
And I was looking at it.
Warped.
I was looking at it at the gym going, what the fuck? And then, like, you know, they sit down, and there's just this weird animatronic band playing, and they're all, like, shitty-looking animatronics.
No, but that's exactly what
I hope that,
my childhood
yeah, I hope
memories
that
are in
effect.
Nathan's
like,
and Chuck E. Cheese.
Like, obviously, if they knew how to make animatronics, they would make it look better, but I think you're right. They might be on purpose that they look so ratty
those
and
things,
shitty.
I mean, and also, you know, like, Invader Zim?
Yeah.
Like, Invader Zim definitely, like, played off of that shittiness and, like, made jokes about
oh,
it.
Oh, yeah, no, yeah, yeah. I know what you're talking about. They have anime, like, the robot parents and all that shit. Yeah. But, yeah, definitely I can see, after seeing that one sequence with these cheap fucking scary robots, that they could make a Five Nights at Freddy's movie, because they're supposed to make it. And just watching that scene, I was like, yeah, okay, that makes sense. Like, I would be fucking shitting my pants. They even have sort of walk-through haunted houses.
Mm-hmm.
With that Five Nights and Freddy theme, so basically they basically rebuild a complete sort of Chuck E. Cheese's, but they uh-huh. fuck it up, so it's like a haunted house, and you're just walking through empty Chuck E. Cheese's, and the robots are just standing
God,
there
are they
playing.
Scary? I'm looking at it right now.
So like, Five Nights and Freddy's, they actually have walk through plays like that. Anyway, so I mean, really, it was a long episode we're doing, but that stuck out to me because that song is still playing on, and then he goes. I guess he's explained to about how the octopus works, and mm-hmm. then he goes into a bathroom and he just kills a guy in like a really funny scene and just throws the guy out the fucking window into the sea, which was like okay, like I mean they're not gonna check for his handprints or something,
right?
And then he has like a he sees that girl, the girl that he you know she killed, she died by running into traffic,
right?
And then he wakes up, I mean after she turns into some sort of weird
and
fucking
he's home,
spider.
Yeah.
And he goes home, so you don't know what's real and what's fake. And that leads up to the end where the lady basically wants to take him by force because she's been...
Oh, I hated that lady.
She wanted to... But listen, you understand why she's doing what she's doing because she thinks... Obviously, the brother's not really taking care of him. He maybe is, maybe he isn't. But
he has his own basement and lives in a mansion. He's fine.
So she's like, I don't know what... Maybe she wanted him to pay or something. I have no clue what her drive was to have this guy at her place so badly.
She was just so obnoxious. Like, oh, I hated her.
And she looked like Janine from the fucking Ghostbusters. That's the thing that was throwing me off. And
I could see that.
So she comes in with a couple of cops. I think that was with the Sklar brothers, who are like these two comedians. They're twin brothers.
Okay.
Because they're like these Jewish brothers. And it's like, that's why he was able to reach through himself through the mirror. Because those mm-hmm. are actually twins, twin actors. They're called the Sklar brothers. And they're like, they're sort of that hipster kind of comedy. Mm-hmm. They've been around for a long time.
Oh, wow. You know the doctor was in Erie, Indiana?
Ooh, that's cool. Hey, here's a funny joke. They rebooted Erie, Indiana, like, uh-huh. on TV a couple years ago. And obviously, they couldn't use the original kids because the kids were probably, like, fucking 30 years old by the time the new version came out.
Right.
And there's a scene where a kid turns on his TV set, and he sees the two original kids from Erie, Indiana, And they just repurposed old footage and put dubbed in new voices. So it's worst fucking.
Really?
Just look up the first episode of the Eerie Indiana reboot and you're like, what did they do? And it's just like, oh man, you must be on the other side of the world. And like, it's not matching their mouth, like a karate movie. And it's like their heads are moving slow motion and shit. It was like the only footage they could shoot of them.
Right.
It's really bad. I wanted to look for that online. It's so bad. So the movie leads to this finale where, you know, the evil version essentially has sucked the main guy, Dennis, into the mirror, the dark world, because he's telling him, oh, you would love it here and I would love it out there. I guess the evil, I don't know what's going on. I don't know if it's really evil. I don't know, because he's a genius, his mind got twisted. I don't know anything. It's a movie about aesthetics.
I think that there was a real paranormal guy.
Okay.
I do think that. Because some of the stuff he does,
he wasn't able to get, apparently what he says in the beginning, he wasn't able to turn anybody else evil, but Dennis was able to kind of follow along. Why he took so long? He took 30 years. I guess he lives another
big mirror.
Okay, so I guess that's not the only mirror he's stuck in. He must have been in other mirrors in other houses, I assume. Yeah. If that's what you're saying.
Well, he is. He was in the bathroom mirror too.
Okay, whatever. So it leads to this ending where he kills the lady. It's really, there's some weird shit you can tell that was like shot years ago and then placed with new stuff where they just didn't have footage to connect it. Mm-hmm. And anyway, so this leads to the final scene, which is the piece de resistance. I mean, it's fucking fantastic. I love this scene. This one last 10-minute scene, 15 minutes, is the greatest part of this film. And it's worth just watching just for this sequence where...
On a very separate note, Joe Dante, the director, directed like several episodes of Eerie Indiana.
Oh, that's why it was probably good. I mean, I remember one joke in that I think it was a mummy episode. To me, I don't care about mummies unless it is like,
has
Brendan Fraser, like 1 and 2. Right. I don't really not into mummy movies because it's just sort of like one zombie and he's slow, so I can't get into them. Except for the mummy
made
movies.
Made of like toilet paper.
Except for the first two Brendan Fraser movies. But there was a mummy episode of Eerie Indiana and it was fucking hilarious, so that was worth watching. But anyway, so this leads to the sequence where the brother's essentially shown his history. Dennis is showing his history to John and making him confront what he really did. And it's a really complex, beautifully crafted, artistically beautifully looking scene where he's doing a puppet show with the corpse of Lydia. And I didn't even know it was her, just because I guess he removed her eyes or put these other eyes in her eye. I mean, they were
so
different colors
looking.
And like, because it was all from far away when he's doing the puppet show with her.
Yeah.
And like, she's just moving, he's doing his voice over hers, and it was just like, and then when they showed her up close, I was like, oh my, I was like, I got goosebumps at how weird
it
looked. Yeah,
it is pretty
It's ghastly looking, because it looks like her jaw doesn't, not even on the same
face. Because his hands, you know, inside her mouth.
Yeah, it's just a weird looking face, and I was like, God. And then like, it just goes insane. Like, he has these puppets, like one hitting his brother over the head, and I guess these are all people that he's killed recently. I wish they would have shown him killing more people in the film, because you've only seen him kill like two people, really.
Well, kid.
But there's like an old man who's playing the doctor who's dead. Oh, I guess that was the psychiatrist? I wasn't sure.
I guess so. Well, everybody they know was missing.
Okay, so it's the psychiatrist, and then there's the woman who was the child advocate or whatever. She comes out as a giant spider, and I was like, what the fuck? And like, the wires break. So it's it's a really nightmarish scene. It's one of the best scenes I've ever seen in a horror film, just for insanity.
Good.
And somebody said the right thing. They were like, this is some... This dude, he was reviewing it. He's like, this is some Silent Hill shit. And I was like, that's exactly what it is, because it's pure insanity. It was black guy who did the voice. That's why it was funny. But it was like pure insanity. Like, I didn't know what the fuck was. It was just bizarre. And then he gets pulled out by the cops at the end. Four or five cops who just don't even say anything. They just arrest him. They just pull him out and arrest him. And I gotta say, I love that. I love that last scene. It's fucking incredible. There's enough weirdness in this film. Like, the real weirdness, obviously, is the dream sequences. And apparently, they shot a lot of stuff that didn't make it into the final scene. Like, in the interview with
Fred Kohler. Oh, I would have loved to see the
He said that there was a negative version. You know how when you look at a negative of a photograph where everything's black and white? They apparently painted everybody white to have a whole dream sequence where everybody was like a negative color of a photograph. But I guess they never did anything with it. When I was like, fuck, man.
They should make another movie of just
the Oh, just of all the nightmare shit must have looked incredible. Because, I mean, you can tell this is a movie. Like, after watching, I was like, this guy was the real deal. Mm-hmm. Trying to make this film. It was like sort of Ed Wood. You know, that's the movie that they said. Ed Wood's Planet from Outer Space. Like, you know how people think it was a cult movie? Like, this would be a cult film, too.
Yeah, but that was a bad movie.
But you know what I mean? It's a cult. You and I can appreciate this film. I'm sure there's other people see this and go, what the f-? You know, this is a stupid movie. But there's so much artistic quality in this film that you and I can appreciate it. Do you know what I mean? So it's a bizarre fucking film.
We should rate it, actually.
Yeah, I would actually give it an 8 out of 10. It should be a 7 or something. But I'm giving it an 8 just for the strongness of the artistic quality of this film. It's a really fucking... It's not a movie that is great all around, but it's watchable and it's not terrible. So I don't know how to explain it. It's just good enough, but then the great enough parts overpower everything else. There's like three or four sequences. Backstory. There are three or four sequences in this film that, like, I think they're always saying there's movies should have three great wow moments. Yeah. And this movie has about four or five of them scattered about. And I was like, wow, I was really appreciative. So I would give it 8 out of 10. Wanting to fuck the ice cream girl, and she eventually becomes a chip witch. I couldn't find an appropriate ice cream name, but go ahead.
I'm gonna give this a 9 out of 10. Finding, you know, somebody you know is in a panic. Oh my god, call the cops. But I don't wanna.
That really bothered you.
I really, like, my jaw was hanging open. I couldn't believe that they allowed that into the movie, because everything else, like, even the bad parts were like, oh, it's not that bad. But that was like, whoa, this is like really bad acting. What's happening here?
And with that, Danny, what's the final word?
Gesundheit.